Hello everyone, thank you very much for joining me again in this stream for Spring Security Fundamentals. Here is lesson number 22nd and we are going to discuss about single sign-on. So we continue our OAuth 2 path and soon we'll finish with everything that goes to authentication, a very big section of this course, so that in the next lessons we can then go further to authorization. Again, thank you very much for joining. You have a live chat there. If you have questions, leave me your questions in the live chat. If you are watching the event recorded, you can, as you know, leave me questions in the comment section, or you can find me on LinkedIn or Twitter. We just have to continue with our course today with an example, a project as always. So I will share you my screen and we will start on working with a project, and I will show you some visual, of course, also to make you understand easier, to make your learning easier about how the single sign-on works with Spring Security. So we'll be using a new DSL method. I think you remember in the previous lesson we discussed about a DSL method that is called OAuth 2 resource server. And you've learned to use that to create a resource server instead of using the Spring Security OAuth project, which is going to be legacy, is already legacy, but is going to be used less and less in the future, in the near future. You know that using the DSL method is basically part of what comes next in the implementation of Spring Security applications for an OAuth 2 system. But as I've told you, you need to learn both approaches. We have some more DSL methods to discuss, and one of them is the one that we'll discuss today, which is called OAuth 2 login. Let's just create a new project and I will discuss it while writing the code the way I like it most. So here it is, Spring Initializer, and we create here. I see you have already left me some questions in the chat. I've seen your questions. Thank you very much, Valerie, for your questions. I will start now with discussing the very basics of single sign-on, which you will see it's basically using the OAuth framework behind, and that means that implies actually it's using JWT. Well, you say yeah, not necessarily, because you could have had OPAC tokens, but I can tell you it's using actually JWT behind. That's not the biggest deal here. Regarding the auto login after registration by email, we have to discuss that it's a customization. My expectation is that you can implement that using a filter, but anyway, it's something that's a little bit beyond the basics. So I prefer to start with the basics, discuss them, and then we will discuss further on, I know, customizations or things that you can do above the fundamentals. So let's do that. Let's start our project for lessons 22nd, I think I said. And we go next, and for our implementation we basically need, of course, I will create a web application, so I need to use the Spring Web Dependency, and because I'm using Spring Security, of course I need to add the Spring Security dependency. And what I'm doing here is basically I'm implementing an OAuth 2 client, so for that I will need to also use the OAuth 2 client dependency here. Then you go next and you go finish, and we have created a new project. And before going into the configurations of this project, I want to tell you what we want to do by using a visual. So I've already prepared here for you my favorite application, where I design diagrams and some icons that you already know. One of them is the one that I've always used to represent the server side. And I have a new icon here that's basically the icon that represents the GitHub logo, because this is what we'll be using as our authorization server today. So instead of building my own authorization server, like you've learned in the previous lessons, using, for example, the Spring Security OAuth 2 project, or by using KeyCloak, we've also implemented a very simple authorization server with KeyCloak in one of our previous lessons. Now what I will be doing is using one of the most known social networks to implement the authorization server. So I've chosen GitHub because, of course, I'm a developer, so I like GitHub very much. But as well, you could have chosen, for example, Facebook. You could have chosen to use a third-party tool like Okta. You could have chosen to use KeyCloak as well, like we've done in one of our previous lessons. So basically, you have a lot of choices here. But yeah, for me, the easiest is to simply use GitHub. And because we are using actually OAuth 2, and we are basically even using OpenID Connect, which is a protocol above OAuth 2, I have described it in various of the previous lessons on this stream. You know, that's basically a protocol that's more restrictive. It restricts the OAuth 2 framework to some more some more constraints that's adding, and that's basically what you will see is that you will recognize the way OAuth 2 works, because we basically still have OAuth 2 behind everything as a framework in our implementation. So that's why the diagram that I will create looks very, very close to what you have already seen previously in our stream. Just that instead of using like a custom authorization server, I will be using GitHub. So what am I doing here? Of course, I will have any kind of user that's registered with GitHub. So I will simply use GitHub to manage my users, which means that I will be able to log in with any user from GitHub. And I will have to register my client here. So the client that I develop, and sometimes when I discuss single sign-on, it's easier to put this on one line, because you will see easier that this is our application actually that we create. Is both the browser representing the front end, but what we'll design is basically the back end rather. And then we have GitHub here that needs to have our client registered. So we need to register our client and secret. And you of course already know what the client and the secret credentials are. And in case you don't know yet what they are, it means that you might have not seen our previous lectures on OAuth. So it's really important that you see them before trying to understand this video, because if you don't have the basics, then of course I will not be able to recap absolutely everything here. So it might be that if you don't know the things that we have already discussed in the previous lessons, you will not understand clearly our today's discussion. So we need to register a client and the secret, and that will be used by our application to identify against GitHub, which is again now our authorization server. So the flow is basically the one that you already know from the authorization code, and the one of the flows that we have discussed in the previous lessons. You know that the user tries to use the application, of course, and what happens is that of course we don't have yet the possibility to access a resource on the resource server, which in our case will simply be a main page that we'd like to enter. So the user needs to authenticate instead of authenticating against the application itself. We will redirect the user that will need to basically authenticate against GitHub. What actually happens is that the user will actually be redirected to GitHub, and they will be able to enter their GitHub credentials directly there. So they will be able to log into GitHub with their user and password that they have available on GitHub. So user and pass. You remember from our previous lessons that we do have two kinds of credentials, the username and the password. When we refer to username and password, we refer to the credentials of the user. For example, me in this case, I will use my credentials, my personal username and password, to log in for GitHub, while the client and the secret, which is the second set of credentials, is the one identifying the application itself. Because GitHub as an authorization server it can offer the services, its authorization server services to multiple clients. So it can be my application using GitHub to log in. Likewise, it can be any other application using GitHub to log in. And I think you might have seen plenty of applications out there where you can log in via some third party like Facebook, GitHub, Okta. Anyway, it doesn't really matter. You use a different authorization server, and it's very comfortable when you have an open application and you want to enable everybody to log in, and maybe you don't want to manage the users and the passwords. You want to allow your clients to log in with something like a social network, and you know that maybe most of your users already have a Facebook account or a Twitter account, then you'd like to use those, you'd like to enable your users use their credentials, their Facebook credentials or GitHub credentials, instead of having to register also and create another set of credentials for your application. And that's less comfortable, of course, when you force your user to register, and then you need to manage their credentials. Then first of all, it's less comfortable for the user, because they have to now they need a new set of credentials, and of course that would be they should actually have a different username or at least password, because you shouldn't have the same passwords for every application that you have out there. And then of course it's your problem to make sure that you secure them properly, and it will be a headache if something happens with your users' credentials and they get stolen by someone. So why not using a different platform for that? Let's use GitHub, let's use Facebook, and leave all these headaches for the developers of that platform, and at the same time enable our users already use some credentials that they already have. So that are the benefits of using a sign-on through a third party, like for example GitHub. So what happens, like in the case of the authorization code, again, you do redirect your user to that third party. In my case, that will be GitHub, and then the user of course will have to log in and authorize their request, and then GitHub of course will redirect back to my application. So we'll tell the client, okay, now the user did log in, so please enable them access the resources, and it will the client will be allowed to access the resources in the resource server. Oh, the most important topic. I'm not sure if it's the most important, honestly. I've seen single sign-on used not really often, especially in big applications, because the applications for which I do consultancy are usually banking or payment systems, and you don't really see a lot of cases in which when doing mobile banking or something, you log in through somebody else. So it is an important topic. It might be one of the important topics, the very important topics, but in my opinion, I do consider most important to have the fundamentals of OAuth, because anyway, the single sign-on is still also something that you use above OAuth. So that's basically what you see here. It's a flow that we have already discussed. It's one of the flows that we have already discussed. When the user comes to your application, you redirect them to an authorization server, and then the authorization server, after the login, redirects back and provides the authentication so that the client can access the resources offered by the resource server. So it's basically the same flow that we have discussed, and I hope by starting with this diagram, I made you first a refresher about what we have already discussed in the previous lesson, and you remembered the flow, the idea of the whole flow, and you know now what we want to implement further. So we want to have this web application, but instead of managing the users ourselves, and instead of creating our own authorization server, we need to use something that already exists. And what I will be doing, I will be using GitHub. So what should I start with in this case? Of course, I've already started with creating the application. You have seen me creating the project at the beginning of our lesson. But before I can actually do something here, I need to have registered my client against GitHub. Because like any other authorization server, GitHub needs to know the client and needs to identify them via usual client ID and secret, the usual credentials you have used with our old previous implementations of OAuth. So what I'll be doing here, I have already opened here a page with my GitHub, and I will now just go to settings, and I will be going to developer settings, and then I will click on OAuth apps, and here is where I basically create a client registration. Do you remember about client registration? It's that set of credentials, that record containing also the set of credentials we have created for absolutely any authorization server we have created. So you might remember you've learned how to use, for example, for the authorization server created custom with Spring Security OAuth, the JDBC client registry. I've shown you how to create a custom client registry at some point because you've asked me how to do that, and I've shown you that you can actually store the clients in the database. Well, basically that's what happens here as well, but now GitHub does that behind. We don't have to program it anyhow, we just have to register our record. GitHub will provide us a client ID and a secret, and then we will be able to use those to identify against GitHub and use the normal OAuth 2 flows. And of course, the same way you'd have to do for any kind of other third-party authorization server that you'd like to use. If you'd like to use Facebook, you'd probably go to developersfacebook.com, and then you'll have to register an OAuth app somehow. If you want to do that via some other platform, the same thing. You need to first register the application against the authorization server. You get the credentials, and then you're allowed to do some of the OAuth flows. And usually they are the authorization code and sometimes the client credentials. In most of the cases today, you won't be supported anymore with the implicit code grant type. And we have already discussed why. You know that's less secure, and that's usually why, again, most of the platforms don't support the implicit grant type anymore. Let's continue. I will register my application. I will now actually create an application for you here, but I will delete it at the end. So you basically, when I will commit my code on GitHub, it will contain some username and password, of course. So it will contain some credentials, which is bad. But I will make sure that I delete the registration. So those username, those client ID and secret that I will be provided now with here will no longer be usable. So you won't be able to simply start that. I tell you that because you won't be able to simply start that application once you pull it from my GitHub repository. Make sure that you will redo this flow. You will create your own client and the secret, and then you have to replace those in the code to work. Because of course, if I would keep the application here, I would expose my credentials of that are part of my GitHub account, and I don't want to do that. Of course, I can do that for half of an hour or maybe 1 hour, what our lesson is, but I won't leave it stay alive for longer than that. So what do we say here? It's app1 or whatever name you'd like to specify for your application. And then of course, in our case, it will be, I won't change the port, so it will be localhost 8080. But in general, yeah, you might have your application exposed on a specific domain, and that's the domain where you want to have it exposed. And then you have the callback URL. That's the URL, you remember, on which the authorization server will call your application back once the user logs in. You remember, because when the client will actually need you, the user, to log in, it will redirect you to the authorization server, GitHub in our case, and then GitHub, once the user use their valid credentials and successfully authenticated, then GitHub needs to redirect the user back in the browser to something. And that something is the redirect URI. And that's the same thing we've been doing in the previous lessons with the OAuth, with the authorization code flow. So yes, this is basically why you need to register. Where was I here? Why I need to register the callback URL, because this is basically the URL that GitHub will call back when the user correctly authenticates. And then I will register my application. And of course, once I have registered my application here, I have the client ID and the secret. And again, once I end with this lesson, I will just delete this application. To delete the application, you just go to advanced and then you delete the application, and then the credentials are no longer valid. They cannot be used anymore. So we will only use these credentials while I teach you in this lesson, and then you will have to create your own credentials. Of course, you cannot use mine or the ones that I present here. So I got the client ID and the client secret, which is perfect. Again, by the way, if you forgot, you can actually click on about to documentation here, and you will basically, I have a question. Can we use Pixie instead of client ID and secret? So this is more secure, and only client ID needs to be defined for the registration. So basically, with implicit one, you can also do Pixie. Do you think this is secure as code flow with Pixie? Honestly, I didn't. I did only use Pixie with authorization code one type. I have no idea basically if GitHub supports Pixie. So for the moment, in this presentation, I will show you with the client ID and secret, and then I will go back to the documentation, because I was trying to show you where you find the documentation, and I will check out if GitHub supports Pixie as well, and I will tell you that. So for the moment, being that this is the first lesson anyway, I think it's enough if you understand the flow with the client ID and secret. And then if you'd like to do authentication with a key, which is the Pixie flow, then we'll have to see what actually GitHub supports, and I will try to see that. Hopefully that answers your question. So you see, actually it's precisely the full documentation covering the OAuth part supported by GitHub here, and you will find here all the parameters, you will find here all the URLs that you need, you will find the access token. Oh, actually, you see, it's basically, I said it's JWT, but I can see in the documentation this is basically it's an opaque token the way it looks here. So again, by the way, I didn't document a lot on how GitHub works, so now my plan is for this lesson to make you understand the configuration of Spring Security. I don't really care precisely if it's GitHub, Facebook, or something else. Of course, when you do implement something on yourself, you will document very well on how the authorization server works and which are the flows that you need to support. So I didn't do that. My plan is just to show the Spring Security configurations that you have available, and then of course it's your duty to read how GitHub works, Facebook, or whatever authorization server you'd like to use. So yeah, that's why all the authorization servers basically provide you the documentation explaining you what they implement and how can you work with that. And yeah, you can find it, for example, in case of GitHub, it simply shares you a link right here. So should the callback URL be the same or different for all authorization servers? If we connect, no, I don't think it needs to be the same, because if you, for example, have GitHub and then you have Facebook, and then you want Facebook to simply redirect you to some different URL, you can simply register a different URL for Facebook than for GitHub. So it doesn't need to be the same for all the authorization servers. Yeah, it simply needs to be the URL you need that authorization server to redirect to. Usually is the same, but it's not mandatory. For example, you might have different URLs just because you want to track how many of your users actually do login via Facebook and how many do login via GitHub or something like that. And then by using different URLs, you can simply track that very easily because you see how many have accessed that link. I don't know. But yeah, you can actually have different redirect URLs as long as your application manages them correctly, because then The redirect URL is only the URL on which the authorization server will redirect you to once the user authenticates correctly. But from there, so it's your application's duty to simply manage what happens with that URL and to redirect the user further if it's needed. Sometimes the redirect URL simply goes further to another page. It's your application's logic. From starting from there, it's simply your application logic, and you know how to implement it. And yeah, I need only now to have the client and secrets. So let's go back to our project and see what do we need to add here. First of all, I should have a very, very basic web application. So what I will do, I will create a controllers package. And inside the controllers package, I say, let's implement the main page, main controller, let's call it, which is the main page controller. And then I will simply, in this case, this is not a single page application, it's simply a web application with Spring MVC flow, standard Spring MVC flow. So I will simply add a controller there. I will make sure I add a page here. And then I will this way is the easiest for me to simply prove how it works. So I will create a main HTML page here. I say something like, I don't know, blah blah welcome, so something that we see basically that we are on the correct page, and it should be enough for what we want to prove here. Otherwise, you can actually have any kind of page to which you redirect. So it doesn't really matter how your web application is built. It simply need to redirect to something that will provide them to the browser, something that it can interpret and execute. In my case, it's a very, very simple and small HTML page. And I have created this controller here. And of course, I need an action method here. Say get mapping and return in this case directly main HTML, which is the path to the physical view, so the path to the page that will be rendered and then delivered as a response back to the browser. And that's it. It's enough for us. We have a page. Let's implement the most important part, which is the login, because that's why we are actually watching now this video, is for the login part. So let's create a config package. And inside the config package, we have the usual project config or security config or whatever you want to name it. So project config, which is a configuration class, and then which extends the web security configurer adapter as usually. You know, you have to extend the web security configurer adapter, and then most of the configurations we do by overriding the configure method. And here we have, as you already know, the possibility to specify the DSL method that will simply add the specific filter on the filter chain according to the type of authentication method that we select. So here is where I told you how to use HTTP basic, for example, where I told you how to use form login. And in one of the previous lessons, you have even seen that you can implement an OAuth 2 resource server using a DSL method. And I told you this is basically the approach that you'd like to use instead of using the Spring Security OAuth from now on. But again, remember, both the approaches with Spring Security OAuth as well as using the DSL method are important, and my recommendation for you is to know the basics of both, so that when you get on a project using either of them, you will be able to understand and work with each of these methods. And that's because the Spring Security OAuth project, even if it has been marked as deprecated and is now considered legacy, there are a lot of projects out there still using it. So it's a great chance that you will need to you will need to work with the Spring Security OAuth project. I guess in a lot of situations, a lot of cases, nobody will change that anymore in those projects. So yeah, you will still face cases in which you need to know that. And now, besides that, you know also that we have the OAuth 2 login and the OAuth 2 client. Now, The method that we discuss today is the OAuth to login, which refers to logging in with using a third-party authorization server. That's basically what we discuss today. And you have this, I think is the last DSL method that we didn't discuss. We won't discuss it today, but for you just to know it's there, and we'll probably discuss in a future lesson. That's the OAuth to client. It enables you easy implement a client from a Spring Security application. So usually the Spring Security application is either a resource server or an authorization server, the way you have seen it in our previous lessons. But in some cases, it also might act as a client. For example, if you have to call another backend, and that backend is also secured using a mechanism implemented over OAuth2, then to call that backend, you will probably have to use the logic of a client. In many cases, when a backend calls another backend, it uses the client credentials grant type, which we discussed again in the previous lessons. And of course, you can do that manually, like calling the token endpoint and then getting the JWT token or whatever OPAC token you have there, and then calling the endpoint. But sometimes you don't want to simply re-implement that logic because it's the same, and Spring Security provides you with that, so you can use that. Can OAuth to login work with phone login? Well, basically there are two different things. To your question, the answer is no, because yeah, it's one replaces the other. So when you use the OAuth to login, you fall on this diagram here, where the client redirects the user to the authorization server, and this is something mandatory to happen, because then the user introduces their credentials against the authorization server. So imagine what would happen if something like that, like using the phone login, would be possible in this case. That would mean that the user will actually need to enter their credentials through your application. And which are their credentials? Their GitHub credentials. So do you think that would be something secure, enabling the user putting their GitHub or Facebook credentials through some application? Nobody would do that, because you don't want to share your credentials, your GitHub or Facebook credentials, with some other application. So no, you won't be able to use the phone login with this single sign-on, just because it's actually mandatory to have the user only providing the credentials directly to the only entity that is allowed to see them, which is the authorization server. So if you use your GitHub credentials, only GitHub can see the credentials. If you use Facebook, only Facebook can see the credentials. You will never be able to go through the application. Otherwise, that would mean you share your Facebook credentials with some other application, and that's not secure. I hope I've been clear with my explanation. So now, of course, when you set the OAuth to login, you have configured the filter that deals with all this authentication logic on the filter chain. And you know that on the filter chain, you basically in the authentication filter place, you will provide a specific filter. That would be, for example, the basic authentication filter. If you'd like to have HTTP basic, it can be the username password filter. If you have a phone login, it can be an OAuth to resource server. If you have a resource server, it can be the OAuth to login filter. In case you have an OAuth to login, that's what we are doing here. And now I'll be doing something that I didn't teach you yet, because in this stream I've decided to first take all that's authentication and discuss only authentication, and then I will go to authorization. But you really need here to actually write also some authorization rule, and that's a very simple rule. I know I didn't teach you yet about matcher methods, but I will explain this instruction very quickly, And that's some of the thing that we'll discuss in detail in one of the next lessons. It might even be already the next lesson. I will decide after this video. So I need to say authorize requests, and I say any request authenticated. So I will again teach you in the next lessons all the details about authorization, because what I'm doing here, it's called authorization at the endpoint level, but this is a very, very basic rule that probably all of you can understand. What I'm doing with line 14 is telling Spring Security that the next things following in the configuration refer to authorization. So the authorization of the requests, which means authorization rules at the endpoint level. And then the only rule that I specify is that any request needs authentication. So you need to be authenticated. It doesn't matter who you are, but you need to be authenticated in order to call any endpoint. So that's because I'd really like that my main page here, which is of course my only endpoint, so I could have referred to it, but I said any request. My main page, which is my only only resource exposed, will only be accessible by authenticated users. So that forces the user to be redirected to my authorization server, which is GitHub, and they will need to of course log in with their valid credentials, and only after that they will be redirected back and they will be able to access my main HTML page. So that's basically what happens here. And to be able to do that, of course, as you probably imagine, I need to somehow specify in the configuration of my application, I need to specify the client ID and the client secret, because my application, as you know from the previous lessons, it needs itself also to authenticate against GitHub. So I need to specify this somehow. And the way in which you do it in Spring Security is by using an object of the type client registration. So I know it's also possible to do everything with three lines of code in the application properties or application YAML file. My plan is here not to show you a very simple example. I want you to understand what's behind that, and then I will go to the easy stuff. But I don't want to start with how to do it with application properties, because then you won't understand the mechanism behind this. So I really want you to understand from this video the way this login works behind, and which are the contracts Spring Security needs from you, either if they are given custom or they are defaults from Spring Boot. You need to know the architecture that's behind, so that you clearly know what happens there. And the way you identify the client is by making use of the client registration contract. So what I will be doing here, I will say private client registration, and I create a separate method because it's easier for me to see, and I can call it GitHub client, or GitHub client registration, doesn't really matter. This client registration, you can it's an interface. It's a class that I made the confusion. It's not the interface, it's a class directly, but the idea is that its object actually holds all the details you need to know, the authorization servers need to know about the client. And that's the client ID, the client secret. Usually you give a registration ID. That's not necessarily part of what the authorization server knows, but it identifies the client registration on the upside. And then all the other things that might be needed, like if you need the authorization code grant type, you need the redirect URIs in some situation, you need to provide scopes in some cases that you request. So all these being the details that are needed for covering those requests we have discussed of the OAuth 2. Of course, you can create your own client registration, and that simply means it's basically a factory or a builder. It's a builder actually here that you can use, and you have to provide all this. So I see another question here. Can we configure auth login and from login both option in Spring Security? If I click on sign in using GitHub, it will redirect to GitHub. If I enter username and password, that's a good question. I think, okay, now I understand. Basically, that was your question. So you actually want one or the other. Well, basically, I didn't try, to be honest with you, I didn't try to configure both, because in most of the cases, when you choose to use GitHub, you usually do that to avoid managing your own users. Now, if you'd like to manage also your own users, well, I will check that and let you know. So I can't have an answer for you now, but I will check that and let you know about if it's possible or not. It might be possible, but I don't want to say yes before actually trying it myself, because, you know, I really like to avoid creating confusion as much as possible. So create as less confusion as possible, if that's a good way to say it. I will prefer actually to create no confusion at all. Okay, so going back, you need to create this object. You either use the builder, but then you have to set up everything. And you can do that, and you will basically do that in case you have a custom authorization server, like you've implemented your own authorization server, or you are using Keycloak, for example, or you are using something that's less known. But what I will tell you is that basically Spring Security is smarter than that, and it knows that in a lot of cases there are some known providers, they are called common providers. And if you want to use one of those common providers, then you don't necessarily need to manually fill all the details, like the URI, the issuer URI, the client ID and the secret, of course, the redirect URIs, everything by your own, because it's a lot of code, it's a lot of things to configure. So what happens is that you have this class called Common OAuth 2 Provider. And inside the common OAuth 2 provider, you have the four, at the moment they are just four, they have the four big considered common providers by Spring Security, and they are GitHub, Facebook, Google, and Okta. So say you are using one of these four, then you don't necessarily need to fill by your own all the details. You can just start by something that already exists. Say you want to use GitHub, and then you say give me a builder for GitHub, and further I only need to specify the client and the secret. I basically also have to add an ID here, so say I call it GitHub, it's the ID of the client registration, and then I say client ID, and here of course I will simply add the client ID, client secret, and then I build my instance. And you guessed, yes, the client ID and the client secret are precisely the ones that I've been provided with by GitHub. And that, again, I will delete all this after the lesson, so you won't be able to use them, but you can anytime create your own. So, and again, very important, I always say that, but I want to say it because I know confusion might happen. Don't forget that these are credentials. You never in a real world scenario put them in code directly. You don't even put them in your application properties file. You usually keep them in a vault. So remember, you have to keep them secure. So I do here put them directly in the code, because it's only an example and I want you to focus on our configuration, not on the way in which we protect the credentials. But in a real world scenario, don't store them in the code. Okay, no, we don't need to put admin annotation, not yet, because as you will see, it's not directly the client registration that is used. It's another contract. It's a contract, actually. That one, the client registration, is basically more a modal object. But we have a contract that is called the client registration repository, and that's basically what's directly used by Spring Security. So yes, I need, of course, to return this here. Allow me just to finish my explanation of creating the client registration, and then when I will go further, you will see that I have to add another component, and that one indeed will be part of the context. So just putting it part of the context, Spring Security will know to take it. So what I did here is only I've told I've created an object that I will use to tell Spring Security where to connect to, and I say, well, I will connect actually to GitHub. And by using again this Commonwealth 2 provider, the only thing that happened is that you see all this information here, that is the scope that I can use, which is called reducer, the authorization URI, the token URI, the user info URI that will be used by my application to get the details. All this I would have had to write myself. And you see they are different depending, of course, Facebook will redirect to something that's of course on the Facebook domain, Okta will redirect to something else. Where is Okta? Here it is. Okta actually needs a URL because I think it doesn't have one specified base URL. And then the Google, of course, will have to redirect to something else. So these informations are different. And someone asked me at some point, but what happens if, say, GitHub changes that? Well, of course, in that case, the some versions of Spring Boot will be deprecated, and then you will have to set some custom things on your own. But in general, this information doesn't change, and that's why they are part of a class now, and they have been created like that just to allow you make your life easier. So you see, when I have used GitHub, I didn't do a lot of things. I'm just using some defaults so that I don't have to manually go myself here in the documentation and search for the issuer URI, authorization URI, user info URI, and so on and so forth. Otherwise, I would have had to go here and find them myself and create my client registration object with that configuration myself. But Spring Boot helps me, and it provides me something to start from, and then it simply creates me this client registration, and I only need to fill the things that of course Spring Security doesn't know yet, which is my own credentials. And that's the client ID and the secret that I have just generated before starting with the example at the beginning of our lesson today. And now you've been asking me if I should add an @bin annotation here. No, that's actually precisely the reason for why I've created this method private, is to somehow make you understand easier that this is not something that I want to make it available for the Spring Security. I don't want to make it available outside the class. I don't want to make it available for anyone. It's just a method to separate the creation of the client registration that represents my client registration at the GitHub in this case. And what happens is that you can actually have multiple client registrations, because if you'd like to have both options in which you connect with GitHub as well as with Facebook, and maybe you want Google as well, then you can simply just create multiple client registrations, and the place where they are actually stored is called the client registration repository. So here is where I create a client registration repository, and this is basically the manager. It's the object managing all the client registrations. I will only have one here, but I could have had multiple. And the client registration repository is the object managing all my client registrations of these applications. So this is the object that I actually need to add to the context, and this is the object that will directly be used. The well-known endpoint summarizes the info, but I still have to call that endpoint. If you refer to finding the information, I still have to call that endpoint and then search for the information and create my client registration. So that means that it's still helping me, the fact that I start from somewhere and I don't have to create my own client registration in this case. Again, the client registration repository is the object that has all this. So I will directly return, and you can have, and in a real world scenario, you would do the same thing you've done with the client, the clients on the auth server, the users, everything else. you store them probably somewhere like in a database. And you can implement this client registration repository, which looks again very similar to what you have seen already. And that's a simple contract which you implement by overriding the find by registration ID. That's how the method is called. And the parameter here is the registration ID, and then it has to provide back a client registration. So in what you do in a real world scenario, you'll probably implement this to store in a database the client registrations, or store them somewhere and not manually provide them as I will do here in the code, because of course, again, you won't like to actually keep credentials in the code and things like this. But for practical, for practice, so for examples, for small applications, Spring Security offers us one implementation of the client registration repository that is called in-memory client registration repository. And as you might already already imagine, this is indeed a simple, very simple implementation that holds all the client registrations in memory. And that's what we'll be doing now, because we don't have a lot of time. I only have 10 more minutes and I really want to finish my explanation. I will use this in-memory client registration repository, but again, it's very easy, and you can do that as an exercise. Implement this contract, and the same way we've done in the previous lessons with, for example, the user details repository and the client details repository interfaces, the same way you can do and implement the client registration repository for this application, so that you store the client registrations in a database. Now, I will use my in-memory client registration repository, and this works very easy. It has a constructor taking all the client registrations, so I can simply call my private method, which will create me the client registration, which will be returned, and now Spring Security will know the client registration that I want to use, because Spring Security will actually call the repository and will try to find this in the repository, and we'll find the exact instance that I return here from the method. And theoretically, that should be it. So it's not a lot of configuration. It's actually very simple. By the way, if you search on the internet, you might find different kinds of implementation. For example, it's the old way of creating single sign-on, having that enable single sign-on annotation. That's deprecated, don't use that anymore. So you can actually do everything just with the DSL method now. So whenever you see that that annotation, just remember, usually you don't need that anymore. You see, the configuration is very easy. It's just a method that you have created. You don't have to work a lot for that. And it's time to test our implementation. Now I'm curious what happens. So I will actually log out, because if I don't log out, then I will probably be automatically logged in, because and you will not see what happens. You won't then trust me that I really have implemented the login. So I have logged out from GitHub, and now I call localhost 8080, and then my application asks me to log in. And of course, because I'm using single sign-on, and because of the configurations that I've created, now I'm redirected to the login page, and you see the client ID specified and the return to. If you remember, we have discussed the entire flow some lessons ago, so a few weeks ago, we have discussed this flow for the single sign-on. So the application sees now that I tried to access some resource, but I didn't log in. The client redirects me to GitHub, which is my authorization server. Then I have to log in and authorize the request. I press the sign in, I have to authorize, I say yes, GitHub can do that. And then GitHub, you see the page, it very fast told me that I will be redirected, because what happened there is that GitHub now redirected me on the redirect URL. And now I'm logged in, I can actually enter as many times as I want here. You see, I'm logged in because I have logged in with GitHub, and now I don't have to do that again. As long as I am logged in with GitHub, the application will remember me, because GitHub remembers me, my application will also remember me. So if I even if I log out from this application and I do log in again because I'm logged in with GitHub, it will automatically tell me. How can you save the user in the database? Very good question. Thank you very much. So let me show you something actually here. I hope now the flow is you understood the flow. By the way, I could have actually even shown you the network here and what happens. I didn't do that. Maybe you'd like to do that. I will show you also that the user information gets to the to your application as well. And yeah, generally you won't basically need to you won't basically need to store the details, or at least a lot of details, but you have them. So in if you really need to store them, you can do that. I will show you that immediately. Regarding the session, by the way, the session, remember that as long as you are logged in on GitHub, so it's dependent on GitHub in my case. So you see here, even if I say log out and I do log out, remember that I'm still logged in with GitHub, because I didn't log out from GitHub. So when I press localhost 8080, it won't redirect me anymore to GitHub, because it already finds me on GitHub. So now everything is dependent on GitHub itself. Even if I do log out from my application, if I remain logged in on GitHub, it will automatically respond with the fact that I'm logged in. So the session itself could have a class, have multiple instances to implement Redis to save all to the session data. I'm not sure if I understand that, but I will show you what you get, and maybe that answers your question. So I hope that's at least cleared the fact with the logging in. And what I wanted to show you here, do you remember, maybe you do remember the authorization code grant type we discussed? You will see precisely. So if you don't remember, this is really interesting. Please go back to that lesson after our today's lesson. Go back to that lesson where we discussed the flow, the authorization code flow. I don't want to spend more time because I've discussed that in a couple of lessons already. But you will see in that lesson that I have explained you that after the user logs in and authorizes the request, it is redirected back, and we have even manually from Postman created the flow in that previous lesson. You will find precisely this in our flow in that lesson. You will find precisely this call that we've been doing, where the code, the authorization code, is provided. Do you remember what the authorization code was used for? The authorization code was that first step where in the first redirect, the authorization server provides a unique code for the client, and then what the client does, it uses that code to get back to the authorization server and require again an access token. And then after it authorizes with the code, and this is the call, this is what I wanted to show you, this is the call where you see the code. This was the authorization code my application sent to GitHub in order to get the access token. And then once my application has the access token, it can actually call the resources on the resource server. So this is precisely the authorization code flow. And if you go back to that previous lesson where we discussed that, you will find these calls, and you will find them on the nice diagram I have created together with you. So that's basically what you do now. It's precisely what you have seen in that previous lesson when we discussed in detail the authorization code grant type. Now I will show you something else. I will go here in my application, and I will very, very fast change it to add an authentication object as a parameter here. And usually you don't print that in the console, but for our example here, this is precisely what I will be doing. It's just to show you what I get here automatically. The authentication, if you remember, we discussed again at the beginning of our, in the first, somewhere, the one of the first 10 lessons, that's the authenticated object that during the authentication process, at the end actually of the authentication process, it has been added in the security context. So you might remember the authentication flow that goes through the filters, authentication manager, authentication providers, and then comes back. And at the end, once the user finished and successfully authenticated, the authentication object has been added to the security context. Again, this is very fundamental from my point of view. You really need to know that flow. If you don't remember that, make sure you go to one of the previous lessons, one of the first lessons of the stream, and you remember how that worked. And what will happen is that automatically Spring Security will inject this object here, and this is precisely the object containing the user and all the details about the user. So can we have multiple resource server? Yes, you can do that. To do that, you just need to register more client registrations here. So if you'd like to have login through both GitHub and Facebook, then you do something like this. Say Facebook client, and then you have Facebook here. And then you have, of course, some client and secret for Facebook. And then you make sure your client registration repository knows both of them, and you can have as many as you'd like to. So I hope that answers your question. So of course, again, both these in my example are just a couple of methods I've thrown here, but you basically, in a real world scenario, you'd like to implement the contract and store this information in a database or somewhere, at least somewhere where you have where you can keep this secure. So again, I've printed the authentication object in my console, and I will restart the application to take these changes. Let me do that. And then I will show you again. That's basically, sorry for that. This is basically by my because of my change here. So let me actually comment this out, because we don't have any way some Facebook credentials now. So I will comment it out so that it remains here for you. You remember how to do that if you would like to have multiple, but I won't keep it in my configuration so that I can restart the application and show you what's important. So I've took it out, and I will restart now my application. Of course, that should be something different here when you use it. So my application is started now. I'm going back, and I call GitHub. And I was already logged in GitHub, that's why it didn't ask me again. But what's important now, I'm going to see what has been printed out in my console. And you can see here that in my console, you find the roles, you find the user that has logged in. Do you see it? This is my user here. And you have all the details that have been provided by GitHub. Followers URL, following URL, and so on and so forth. So all these details have been provided when my resource server actually called after a successful authentication. It called GitHub on the user info URL. So everything now, what you see here, is the result of my application calling the user info URI. The user info URI being the URI where the user information is provided, and then it grabbed back all those details, including the username. And then you have the username, you can store it in a database if you'd like, because that was one of the questions. So microservices must communicate with each other by messages through a message broker. The main microservice responsibility technician will be I'm not sure what you want to say. Sorry for that. The message broker is something different. It's a totally different subject. We'll discuss it in a separate stream. So JMS Kafka, that's a message broker, and we'll discuss that in a separate lesson. And I think these were your questions. Okay, so that's basically it. So we've managed to create an application. You have seen in my network tab here the calls themselves, and we have managed to use GitHub. Let me make sure that I do delete my app here, so I will show you how to delete your app as well. I don't want this to stay alive, because otherwise somebody can use them, and that's not okay. So I will now delete my application. Okay, so I've deleted it, and you can't use it anymore. So now if I try to do something, probably I will not be able to use it anymore. If I logged out, then I cannot use it anymore. How do you deal with having multiple instances of your application? Well, I'm not sure what's the problem with having multiple instances of my application. So, I mean, is there any problem with having multiple instances of the application? I guess to the same application, you want to scale it up. You say probably what happens in this case, because you will basically have it in memory or something like that, and then you say you get it on the session and it's not scalable. Probably that's your question. Well, I guess in this case you will have to basically you will actually have to make sure that you have, for example, mechanism that redirects to the same node if you use statefulness, or you simply use a mechanism that doesn't use statefulness at all, something like this, if that was your question. Multiple resource server. If you have multiple resource server, you simply configure multiple applications. That's how you deal with it, because the resource server is basically your application. So you can have multiple applications on your GitHub account. Creating project by using asymmetric key, but when I'm adding public key by using method set verifier key public key, I'm getting an error. So for that question, please leave me a message on the video 18 itself, so we discuss it there. Show me on the let's discuss it separately, because now we cannot discuss in lesson 22. Go back to lesson 18. You might imagine that I have no idea what I've been discussing in lesson 18. So leave me a message for your question of lesson 18 on lesson 18 itself, and I will try to debug you with that. Okay, the max signing. Do you need to specify the verifier key separately? I'm not sure what that is, but let's keep the discussion on lesson 18, because that's no longer any time for that. Yeah, let's discuss it, because again, I don't know errors by heart. So trust me, I don't know errors by heart. I might know a lot of things, but kind of all the exceptions, Spring might get and Spring Security might get by heart. I'd like to be so smart to know them all by heart, but I will have to actually research that myself in case you have something. So if you can share on lesson 18 your GitHub repository with what you have done, I might try to get it and help you with that one. So let's do it like this, so that I can help you. Super. Thank you very much, folks. So I think this is time to end it for today. We've been a little bit over our time, and you have seen the application implemented. Thank you very much for having you here and for asking all these questions and all the comments. I will share you my application and my GitHub account afterwards, and then I will try to help you with all the other questions that you might have. Until next week, and when we meet again, have a great time for studying.